Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Padmavati ma'am. And welcome to today's session of the deep learning course. Ma'am, I have given you the right so that we can start with the session.
Thank you, Sakshi. We will start, right? Okay.
Welcome.
Let me share my screen first. Is my screen visible, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Okay, let us start the deep learning session. Let us try to revise what we have covered in the last class. Okay, so we started with how do we build the feed forward neural architecture. Okay, so the main components of feed forward neural architecture is are three layers comprising of input layer, hidden layers, and output layers. Correct. We have also seen how many number of input layer and output layer and hidden layers are possible in any given feed forward neural network. There will be one input layer, one output layer, and can be multiple hidden layers, correct? And in each hidden layer we can have n number of neurons. Okay. And feed forward neural network, we have also seen that they are densely connected with each other. That means each neuron is densely connected with each other neuron of the previous layer as well as with the next layer. Okay. Apart from this, we have also seen how do we compute, okay, given any neuron, how do we take the input from the previous layer neurons, and how do we compute, how do we perform some sort of computation so that each neuron in the hidden layer will be able to generate some sort of intermediate output. And that whatever output that each neurons are generating, okay, so that will be fed to the fed as an input to the next hidden layer neurons, right? So the name itself suggests that it is feed forward neural network. It means we are feeding the input from input layer to the hidden layer and first hidden layer to the next and so on till the intermediate output generated by each hidden layers will be reached to the output layer. Okay. Apart from this, we have also seen how do we compute the function inside each neuron. That means each neuron will perform some sort of computation in order to generate intermediate result. And we have given the equation in the last session, right? So what type of equation that I have given? I have given that first we will perform linear function with the help of input. And later on top of that linear function, what I will be doing is I will be applying some non-linear function, correct? And later on, what we have done, okay, we ourselves, I have explained in the last class that each neuron will take input from the previous layer and with associated weights and biases as their parameter values, correct? So, for example, this particular neuron will get the input from x1, x2, x3 of x3 corresponding weights also be passed, correct? As well as bias, v1's weight will also be passed to this particular first neuron of the first hidden layer. Similarly, x1, some weights associated with x1, x2, x3's input will be passed to the second neuron and so on. Okay. Now, many authors, whatever we have done, this particular neuron is performing some sort of computation, correct? That is nothing but W transpose X plus B, right? So that particular function, each neuron, they do call, each neuron performs two types of functions. One is pre-activation function, which is linear computation, and the second one is activation function, which is non-linear, okay, non-linear in nature. That means, so for what they are calling it as pre-activation, whatever we are performing that W transpose X plus B, okay, that particular computation, they call it as a pre-activation function. Okay, whatever function that we are performing on linear, as a linear function, that they are calling as a pre-activation function. So you can imagine this particular neuron is divided into two functions. The first function is taking the input from a previous layer, and what it will be performing is, it is performing W transpose X plus B, and that particular input, that particular output, whatever W transpose X it is resulting, that will be passed to function 2 of the neuron. What the function 2 will be doing, it will be performing some sort of non-linear functionality. Okay, in today's class we will discuss what type of non-linear functionality will be performed on that particular output that is generated by pre-activation function. So by this time it should be clear. Many authors, most of the authors, they do break the computation into two parts. The first part as pre-activation function and the second part as activation function. In the first part, that is in pre-activation function, they do perform W transpose X. Okay, and that particular W transpose X result will be passed to the activation function. Now activation function will perform non-linear computation on that particular output. Okay, and again it will, function 2 will also generate some kind of output. That output will be passed further to the next hidden layers neurons. Fine. So with this, we are very well aware of pre-activation function. Okay, that is W transpose X. In the previous class also, we have tried to compute for at least one neuron, we tried to get the output with the help of pre-activation function. Now let us see, how do we compute activation function while taking the pre-activation result as an input? Okay. Why should I perform activation function? Okay, why it is necessary, or what is the role of this activation function? I said activation functions are performing they are meant for nonlinear functionality. Okay, then why do we require nonlinear functionality on top of linear functionality? Why can't we simply do some sort of functions? Okay, why can't we do n number of linear functions? Why should not I apply only linear functions? Why it is important to apply non-linear function on top of whatever linear function that we have computed? So let us see the reason. If we perform only linear function, then what it will do is, it can only represent linear relationship between X and Y, that is input and output. That means, if I want to categorize my output, okay, if I just want to categorize the output in terms of two different classes based on some predefined input. Okay, so in that case, if suppose those outputs, okay, or those data points, those inputs, data points, if they are linearly separable with each other, then after performing linear function, I can easily say, or I can come up with a solution, that if you perform this sort of division, then we can easily say that there is a linear function. There we can come up with two different outputs. Okay. For example, if I want to, let us take some example and let me explain. Okay, now suppose if I have my data points are scattered like this, okay, and these are different data points that I have provided, and I just represented with two symbols because I wanted to distinguish between the class 1 data points with the class 2 data points. Okay, if for my model this particular data set will be unknown, that means it treats each individual point as an input, that's it. Okay, so if we perform only linear function for this, if I want to categorize in this particular problem into two categories, then definitely I will be there are many solution possible solution that I can find. One of the possible solution may be this. Okay, so that whatever data points that lie this side of the line will belong to one class, and whatever data points that lie above the line will belong to the second class. Okay, so if because okay, before that, why I am able to classify into two classes, why I am able to classify this particular data set into two classes, because the data points are linear in nature. Okay, the data points xi, yi, okay, they are linear in nature. That means my input and output, they are able to represent the linear function. Okay, for that sake, I am able to divide this divide this particular given data set into two classes. This is first class and this is the second class. Suppose, let me change to the same problem. Now, for this particular given problem, with the help of single line, okay, I will not be able to classify into two different classes, correct? So why I am not able to differentiate, or why I am not able to categorize into two different classes? Because the problem may not be linear in nature now, okay? This is why we require on top of linear functionality, we do try to apply non-linear functions such that if the data points that is xi, yi, they are non-linear in nature, then also I should be able to categorize the given data points into two categories. Okay. So I should be able to apply, I will always try to apply non-linear function. Fine. And hence, we have introduced activation functions in deep neural networks, right? So you already know this. So with the help of a linear function, we can't solve the non-linear functions, correct? Whereas for this, what we need to do is, even with a deep network, it is not possible to learn non-linear relationship between x and y. Why? Because we may be having n number of neurons in each of the hidden layer. But even though if I don't introduce non-linearity on top of linear function, then definitely, even though I'm making my network very deep, but still I'm not able to represent the x and y. Right, because again, let us take some example and let me illustrate. So what happens? Think that the first, this is a node. This is the first node, that is input node, and this one is the output node. Okay, output layer. This is representing input layer. Instead of like horizontal, I have represented my feed forward neural network in a vertical direction, and every neuron is connected with each other. Okay, so in this particular case, if I'm trying to solve the function, okay? Okay, for simplicity, let us take, there is no bias exist. We are only taking the function, that is w into x. Fine. So whenever I'm introducing this w into x, let me call it as in w1 into x. Okay. This result I will multiply with again w2. Again, on top of this, w3. Okay. So what are we trying, in short, what are we trying to do is, we are trying to compute W transpose X plus B. Even you can consider bias, but just for simpler illustration, I have not considered. Okay. If I take W transpose X and I apply that functionality W into X, then afterwards, if I apply whatever result that I get, that I will feed into the first hidden layer, this particular node, what it is doing, it is taking the input, that is x, from the input layer, and w1, weight, respective weight is associated on that particular input x. Okay, so what I will be performing, as you can recall in the from the previous session, we have done w transpose x into b, x plus b, but for illustration purpose, I have not considered bias, but you can always introduce that bias. Okay, whenever I am doing this w transpose x into b, and this result will be I will feed to the next hidden layer, right? Now, again, it will accept this output from the previous hidden layer as an input. And what it will do, what this particular function will do, it will multiply, it takes weighted average, right? It takes weighted of the weighted value of the output that has been generated by the previous node. Correct. Similarly, like so on, I can introduce n number of, like this, I can introduce n number of hidden units to reach the output. Okay. Even though I have introduced, suppose here I have illustrated with the help of only two hidden nodes, hidden layers, and single nodes in each hidden layer. But you can always have a dense network with multiple hidden layers on top of each other. Okay. But when you apply this particular functionality, you can always see that what we are going to achieve at the end from this, we are going to achieve only one thing, that is W transpose X. Okay. Actually, what is this W is? W is W1 into W2 into W3 and so on. So ultimately, what we are trying to do is, again, even though after introducing so many hidden layers, but still I'm not able to get the details of the hidden representation of the input. At the end, what I'm trying to do, after introducing so many hidden units in the feed forward network, but still I am able to compute with a single operation, I am able to compute all whatever we have computing inside all the hidden units. Correct. So you should understand this. It's very important why we should use nonlinear function inside the inside each of the neuron. Okay, why they have divided every neuron computes two type of functionalities. One is pre-activation function, and on top of that, they are introducing non-linear function. Okay, if we only use linear function, this is the result. Even though we have introduced so many layers, but that is not leading us to anywhere. In fact, it simply performs this sort of computation. Fine. Right, even with a deep network, it is not possible to learn non-linear relationship between X and Y. So let us try to understand what type of activation functions are involved in deep neural network. Few of them I have listed here, and we are going to do all these in today's session. The first one is activation function, that is a sigmoid function. Okay, and in this sigmoid function, again, it represents family of functions, and one I have illustrated is logistic function. Okay, consider for illustration, I have taken one neuron and how this neuron will act based on the inputs. Okay, so as I illustrated that this particular neuron will compute first linear function, that is this particular neuron has z is equals to, it accepts input x and it takes parameters w and b, and it performs this computation w transpose x plus b. Okay, once it computes this linear computation, then what it will do is, on top of this, now I will use sigmoid function. Okay, how this logistic function it takes, or how it represent, it is represented using this particular equation. So it is 1 upon 1 plus e to the power of minus z. Okay, now after performing this, okay, the output of the first function, that is pre-activation function, will be passed to activation function. Here z is same whatever we have computed. Either you represent 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power of w minus w transpose x plus b, or you represent 1 upon 1 plus e to the power of minus z. That is same. Okay, so let us see what will be the resultant values with respect to each of the whenever we pass some arbitrary input. Suppose First of all, the output of this particular logistic function, it always gives the output range is from 0 to 1. Okay, whatever is the input of your inputs, okay, the inputs may be very high, okay, that doesn't matter, the output will be in this particular range only, 0 to 1. Why? Because of this particular property, right? So it scales the output, or it gives the output in between 0 to 1 only. Fine. Suppose if W transpose X is very minus infinity, okay, that is large negative value. Whenever we are taking W transpose X as large negative value, then what it will do is it gives the output as Y equals to 0. Okay, so change this. Someone correct me, what should be this? Whenever W transpose X is large positive value, then Y should be equals to, yes, it should be equal to 1. And you can always compute W transpose X is equals to 0, then Y is representing 0.5. Fine. Let us take some examples on forward propagation. How do we perform forward propagation with the help of feed forward neural network? Considering the activation function on top of this Z, what type of activation function would like to apply? I would like to apply logistic function, whatever we have discussed till now. Okay, so X is not written over here, but consider X as 0.1. Okay, consider X as 0.1. And W1 as 0.15 and bias value is 0.4. Then what I need to do is I need to first compute the pre-activation value, that with the help of W transpose X plus B. And on top of that pre-activation function, what I will be generating is I will be generating activation value. So activation value is generated, whatever result of W transpose X, okay, that will be, treat that as Z is equals to W transpose X, compute that Z value and you pass it to non-linear function, that is 1 upon 1 plus e to the power of minus Z. So once you compute here, you will get the output as pre-activation output as 0.415, whereas activation output, this I asked you to compute Z value first and later on put that Z value over here. Fine. And you will get some activation value. Okay. That comes out to be 0.6023. Okay. Like this, given here, I've given only one neuron and one input, weight and bias. Given this, we are able to compute activation value, that is result of whatever neuron will generate. Okay, so we are able to perform, or we are able to compute that particular value over here. In a similar way, if I give you many hidden layers and if I ask you to compute it manually, definitely we don't compute it manually for the deep neural network case or feed forward neural network case, because we do code it, but assuming you know the computation and all the formulas, then if any neural network is given to you, then you should be able to compute the intermediate, that is pre-activation values and activation values associated with respect to each of the hidden units and output units. Okay, so let us try one more example. Here I have not given the forward directions, but you assume by default in feed forward neural network they are in the forward direction only. Fine. Again, x1 take the same input and w1 here 0.15, b1 is 0.4. compute pre-activation value with this particular formula, that is w1 into x1 plus b1. you will get Z1, and you apply that logistic function on this particular Z1 in order to get A1, and this particular A1 will act as an input to this particular neuron in a similar way as we have taken input from the input unit. Okay, X1 was input unit, input from the input unit to the first neuron of the first hidden layer. First hidden layer. This is the second hidden layer, first neuron of the second hidden layer, right? So A1 is passed as an input to the first neuron of the second hidden layer, correct? Again, you perform the same functionality, whatever we have done over here, that is W transpose into X plus B1, okay? Here W is W2, X is A1, plus B is B2. Okay, you perform that. On top of this, you apply whatever logistic function that we have defined, you apply that equation in order to get A2. Okay, someone compute it for me and let me know the answer for this. I have computed up to this.
Ek baar pehle wala bhi batana, 0.6, 0.45, how it came.
Okay, this.
Yeah, from where we take the value 0.1 of X1.
I asked you to assume this X1 is missing over here. I asked you that X1 I have given as 0.1.
Okay,
you need to assume X1, actually I'm passing X1 over here from the input layer. Okay. Right, please continue. We got Z1 and A1. Okay, and A1 will be passed as an input for Z2. And compute that linear function first and later on compute the non-linear function in order to get A2. Okay. We'll compare. I have computed as well in very next slide. Here, whatever value that I have computed, that comes out to be Z2 comes out to be 0.9210. Okay. And A2 is equals to 1 upon, you know, logistic function. You just need to replace Z as 0.9210. It comes out to be 0.7153. Okay. Like this, I've only given for, in this example, I've given very narrow, or you can say very thin network. Okay, comprising hidden layer, first hidden layer, first hidden layer comprising one neuron, second hidden layer again comprising of one neuron. Okay, this is very thin network, right? If I give you very dense network and each hidden layer has n number of neurons, then also one should be able to compute, arrive with this pre-activation values and activation values, and at the end, the resultant, that is output values, right? So let us continue with a sigmoid function of that is logistic function. We have seen this, correct? Let us try to understand what we mean by neuron saturation. This neuron saturation, again, it is a problem that is with respect to logistic function of the sigmoid family. Okay, so first let us try to understand what is this neuron saturation is all about. A small gradual changes in the in a given sigmoid neurons parameter W or B causes small gradual changes in Z, where we can produce the gradual, or it can produce the gradual changes in the neurons activation. Fine. So why do I always take small steps? Okay, suppose again consider this small neuron, okay, architecture. In this, what I have done is I do have only one hidden layer with one neuron and the output layer. And here it should be y hat. Okay, I will correct that. And this is x, that is input. Fine. So in this, what I am taking is I am considering I will be computing as shown in the previous slides. I will be computing first pre-activation function, and on top of that, I will perform activation function. Okay, and I will come up with some solution, that is y. Y hat, actually, let me call it as an y dash. Okay, and I always referred in first two sessions that whenever we do have output, okay, what we do in supervised learning, we do first after computing the predict y hat. Here is the predicted result with a given input with some assumed parameterized values. This w and b, we are assuming some random values. Initially, we don't know what, if I put what w and b values, for what combination of w and b values, exact combination of w and b values, I will be getting y hat, and that y hat is equal to y. Okay, so I initially I do not know what this w and b values are. So for that sake, I always assume some w and some b values. Okay, so assuming some w and b random values, I do compute pre-activation, and on top of that, I will perform activation function, and I get y hat. Suppose this y hat, whatever computed y hat, is coming out to be 0.4, okay, and my actual output is 1. Now, after seeing the result, that is predicted value, when you compare predicted value with the actual value, you will come to know that at least definitely whatever w and b you have assumed, either one of the parameter will be is wrong or both the parameter values are not correct. Okay, why they are not correct? Because x, I cannot change the x is fixed. Fine. What I can only change in that, in those functions, pre-activation or activation function, I can only change w and b. Correct. So some combination of w and b I have kept, and I have computed some value, pre-activation value, and when I performed on top of that activation function, I arrived with some y hat. Correct. Now this y hat is very far off from the y. That means I need to change either w or b or maybe both. Okay, because my desired result, desired output is not similar to the actual output, or my predicted output is not same as my actual output. So what I need to do is I need to again feed this particular loss. I need to inform to the network so that that will be improved. That will be improved means the loss in the next step will be improved. That means this time 0.4 minus 1, the loss is coming out to be 0.6. Okay. Next, in the next layer, okay, I will take your query later on. Okay, don't disturb. At this point, what is happening? The loss is high because it is 0.6. Okay. Now, what I need to do is I need to feed that particular value in this particular network. Okay. I need to inform the network that whatever predicted value, whatever value that you have predicted is wrong. Okay. Not wrong, is very far off, or the loss is very high. So you need to reduce the loss. So how do I reduce the loss? The loss is reduced with respect to some parameter after computing some parameter updates. Okay, how do I compute the parameter update? Parameters updates are computed. I have given a detailed function or equation in the next slide, coming slides, but it is computed with w is equals to w new is equals to w old minus some constant value, that is eta, multiplied by some derivative with respect to each of the parameters. The derivative of error with respect to w and derivative of error with respect to b. What I am trying to do, suppose if my loss is very high, what I am trying to do is I will check by changing what w value. Okay, my w value may be either high, whatever expected, or whatever w should be. Okay, there is some ideal w and ideal b value that we do not know. Okay, and let me draw one line and explain. Fine. So this horizontal line is representing some w values. Some w values. Initially, I have taken w value is very, very small. Okay. And when I take w, ideal value is this, suppose. And I have taken very, very small w value. Definitely, ideal value is this, and I have taken very small value. So for what value I need to do? I need to compare. So I need to increase the value of w in this particular case. Okay, I need to increase the value of the w in this particular case because I want to reach this particular ideal value. In a similar way, suppose my random value, whatever value I am initializing over here, I have initialized very high values. Okay, over here, suppose. Now, I know ideal value. After seeing this particular line itself, I can say ideal value is over here, and I've taken w value or initialized w value with higher w's. So at this particular case, what happens? Again, you will get loss y hat minus y will be very, very high. Okay. So for at this particular moment, what I need to do is again, I need to change the w. Okay, so that particular w need to be decreased this time, whereas in the previous case it is we were trying to increase, whereas this time we are trying to decrease. So this is nothing but updation. Okay, updates that we need to do with respect to parameters. So when we do update, whenever we are doing back propagation, then we are updating the parameter value. Here, just for illustration, I've taken w like this. Otherwise, we need to take updation with respect to each of the weight values and with of each neuron and with each of the biases I need to consider. That means I need to update the w vector as well as I need to update the bias vector. Why I'm saying vector in terms of vector? Because there may not be single neuron in the hidden layer. There may be multiple neurons. So with respect to each neuron, I need to update the W's. Okay. So for that sake, what I need to do is I need to update the W values in such a way that the previous W value, whatever we have taken, okay, the loss was very high. So what I need to do is I need to change the W value such that whatever change that I'm taking from earlier was W was here. Next W may be this. Okay. So that particular, now again, with this particular combination, when you compare, when you compute Y hat, definitely loss will be decreased because instead of giving W value of this value, I have increased the W value and I'm passing it. In a similar way, if it is very high, my loss was very high. Okay, so for that sake, I will decrease the W to some extent. Okay, I will not decrease the W's entirely with high unit or high magnitude value. Instead, I will take a small baby steps and I will try to decrease the loss. Okay. This is clear to you, fine. So for this, whenever we are trying to update the values, what is expected is the updated values, okay? After the back propagation step, we do update the values. And when I need to feed the updated values with the current input, And again, I need to check. And this time loss should be less as compared to the previous one. Okay. So small gradual changes in a given sigmoid neuron's parameters W and B cause very small gradual changes in the Z. We all know if I change W or B or both, then Z will be changed automatically because Z is dependent to variable over here and W and B are independent, right? So whatever change that you are doing, that will be reflected in Z also. If you are changing very high the difference is very high, or you are taking instead of small change, if you are making large change, that will also be reflected. But for weight updates, we always take the small steps. For let's say I have written over here, right? Small gradual changes in a given sigmoid neuron parameter W or B cause small gradual changes in the Z, thereby producing gradual changes in the neuron's activation. Suppose a large positive values or large negative values of Z, it illustrates some sort of exception. What type of exception it will generate? It generates sigmoid neuron will output either 1 or 0. If you put large positive value or large negative value, thereby the updates to the weights and biases during the training process will have very little or no effect on the output. Okay, that means the learning will stall. That means the learning will be stopped. But what was my motive behind taking small steps? Because I just wanted to reduce the loss. Okay, at each iteration, I just want to reduce the loss to some extent such that the loss of the current step is less than the loss at the previous step. But whenever we are taking high positive value or high negative values, then definitely my based on the formula, you might have seen what that formula will indicate. It gives you either 1 or 0. Fine. Whenever 1 or 0 is there, then I cannot take the or if I take the derivative of functions, whatever 1 and 0 output on top of that, if I want to find out some derivative value, then that derivative value will come out to be 0 only. Okay, so whenever we do compute some derivative value and that derivative value comes out to be 0, then what type of change that we are making? We are not making any change. That means we are not able to update the weight and bias values. For example, for large positive values, let us take a large positive value here is 20. So when I put computed pre-activation values that comes out to be 20, then 1 upon this comes out to be, this is very, very low value. Okay, e to the power of minus 20 comes out to be very low value, that is equal to 1. Okay, so 1 upon 1 dot something, 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 that is that I consider as approximately equal to 1. So it comes out to be 1. Okay, so this is the case when our value, that is Z value, is very high, that is large positive value. Even for large negative value, let us say instead of taking plus 20, I have taken minus 20, that is Z value comes out to be minus 20, suppose. So at this particular case, this e to the power of 20 plus 20 comes out to be very high value. Okay, 1 upon this high value will comes out to be approximately 0. Okay, so neuron saturation will occur whenever we do take high positive value or high large negative values. Okay, if for high positive value it comes out to be 1, and for high negative value it comes out to be 0. Fine. So here again, I have tried to illustrate with the help of equation. So suppose E here is error. When E error is very high, then we need to update the parameters of the neuron. Here parameter of the neuron, by this time it might be very easy to tell you, or you will be easily understand what are parameters of the neuron. Only two parameters, W and B. Correct? So here, just for illustration purpose, I have not considered B. Otherwise, B can also be computed with the same formula. B is equals to B minus eta into the derivative of, with respect to derivative of error with respect to W. Fine. So once we have arrived the same example, once we have computed this y hat and y hat is very far off from the y, then what I need to do is I need to update the weights. Okay, so I need to update the weights in such a way that based on this particular equation, I will update where this W is W nu. This is going to be updated, right? W nu is equals to W weight, whatever weights were previously assigned, minus eta times this. Okay, this is the function. If the function is resulting with either 0 or 1, okay, as compared to previous case, if the function, that is logistic function, it is either resulting 1 or 0. At this particular case, whenever I take the derivative of error with respect to W, what happens? Because function has returned, has the value 0 or 1, then its derivative will remain 0. Okay, suppose its derivative is remained as 0, then nothing to learn, right? With the help of back propagation step also. W is equals to W minus some eta value, constant value, multiplied by 0 again. Fine, either the function, the A value, that is resultant of the neuron, that is activation function, if it is giving me 0 or if it is giving me 1, then the derivative with derivative of E with respect to W will remain 0. Okay, that means updates to the weights and biases during the training will be very having very negligible effect or no effect. At least in this particular case, whenever we are taking extreme 0 or 1 as the output of the function, then derivative will become 0. Derivative of E with respect to W will become 0. So in this particular case, no updates will happen. No updates will take place. When no updates are taking place, that means I'm not able to reduce the weight. I'm not able to reduce the loss in the next step. Again, you form the you need to loop back again and again over the iteration and over the iteration, till there will be very, very negligible effect. That means very small change may take place in W, or if you have taken extreme or the result of activation function is very high or very low, then the derivative as it is, it comes out to be exactly 0. At this particular case, I can easily say that no updates will take place. That means W will be will have the same weight as the previous step. Then what is the fun of using same weights? What is the fun of using same weight and bias values over and over? Okay, with each iteration step, you will get the same result. Okay, so here we are not able to reduce any loss. Getting it? So for that sake, we say, if we use logistic function as an activation function in the neurons, then the problem occurs. That particular problem, we call it as a vanishing gradient problem. Okay, there are two different problems in neural network, deep neural networks. One of the most important problem, or critical, you can say, that problem is vanishing gradient problem. This is what vanishing gradient problem is about. Okay, the gradients are not being updated with each step, and that means the learning will remain, will not take place. If learning is not taking place, then over the entire training period, your weights will remain same only. If weights are same, then it is very much clear from the equation or from the figure that we are not moving towards the correct solution. We are somewhere, we are compromising the output with some high loss error rate. Okay. Okay. Now this the problem is known as vanishing gradient problem, and by this time you know the gradient of loss with respect to the weights are actually vanishes. That is zero. So learning will halt. Fine. The disadvantage of logistic function, whatever we have discussed, that is 1 upon 1 plus e to the power of minus z. Okay, there are three different problems. For that sake, we try to avoid logistic function in the deep neural network. The first problem is very much clear to you, vanishing gradient problem. The second problem is it is not zero centric. Okay, it is not zero centric means. Okay, it is not zero centric means whenever you are doing, don't have I given any equation or formula? I have not represented in the form of. Okay, wait. This means let me tell you, maybe I will update the PPT and send you. So this particular problem means on the y-axis, what happens, whatever is your input, whatever is in your input, either high input or low input. Okay, low input is nothing but negative input or positive input. What we have seen the output ranges between 0 to 1 only. Okay, so it is not zero centric. Fine. Zero centric means some value for some set of values, input values, I may be getting positive value. That is, my y should be higher than zero. And for some set of negative values, my output should be lesser than zero. Okay, so my y value, y instead of 0 to 1, here it is not zero centric means for some input it should be higher than 0, for some input the y could have been lower than 0. But the equation itself suggests that or represents that. Based on the equation only, we can easily try to understand that my y value is not zero centric. That means for all the values of for any values of or any set of inputs, I will be getting values above zero or below one. No values will be below zero. Okay, so why we should consider zero centric function again? If we consider zero centric activation function, okay, apart from this logistic function, if we consider some other zero centric activation function, that it will ensure, or it means that the mean activation value is around the zero. Okay, so whenever we are taking mean value around the zero, that means normalize, it gives the normalized data. Whenever we do have some normalized data with us, we can easily say that my problem will converge very fast. Okay, or I can be able to reach the destination, or I can be able to reach zero loss very fast as compared to non zero centric functions. This is been proved empirically. In subsequent sessions, you can try yourself, you can keep logistic function, and you need to perform some kind of, or number of iterations will take you very high. You need to take iterations, or you need to consider iterations very high as compared to if you take zero centric functions, then definitely your data is around zero, and that is normalized data, and it will take you with less number of steps only, you can take the result very fast, or you reach the low loss, least loss, with very high, okay, with a very high results. So this is what non-zero centric means. Here logistic function is non-zero centric. Okay, so in simpler words, it takes convergence takes much time. Fine. And logistic function is computationally expensive. Why it is computationally expensive? Because every time I am computing one upon with respect to each activation function, you have seen the formula. The formula is I need to compute 1 upon 1 plus e to the power of some value. Okay, that computation of e to the power of some value is much computationally expensive as compared to some other activation function. Hence, we try to avoid this logistic function. Okay, this also exists. This problem is also there in vanishing gradient problem of logistic regression. That means in this example, I have taken very simple neuron, very simple network with only one neuron. Suppose I take very dense network, at that particular time, what happens? Layers or hidden layers very near to output layer will converge or will learn much faster as compared to hidden layers which are further away from the output neuron. Okay, or I can say hidden layer which are closer to the Y or output layer will learn quickly as compared to layers which are further away from the output layer, or the layers which are placed near to input layer. Okay, this we will illustrate with the help of example, maybe in the next session or maybe in subsequent session whenever we do deal with back propagation. Okay, we will take this again. We will see how this is valid. Next function is tanh function. Okay, so this tanh function, it represents the equation, that is activation function. Here pre-activation for all activation function will remain same, that is W transpose X plus B, whereas activation function, it changes, it is in this particular form. Fine, you can see here in the previous case the output, that is A, was varying from 0 to 1, whereas here in this case output is varying from minus 1 to 1. You can check the graph also, it varies from minus 1 to 1. One more thing to note here, tanh function is zero centric. For some set of W X plus B, you may get a value lesser than zero. For some set of W X plus B, you may get values above zero. Hence, if you use tanh function, convergence will take place quickly as compared to logistic function. Okay, so for negative input, you can illustrate this by equation only. I will leave it to you. Let us see some advantages and disadvantages of using tanh function. It is scaled version of the sigmoid function, correct? Instead of 0 to 1, that is logistic function, we have taken minus 1 to 1. So hence, that is scaled version of the logistic function. It is symmetric over the origin, correct? And the disadvantage, whatever problem that lies with vanishing gradient problem, it remains in the tanh function as well. It remains in the tanh function. Okay. That means the update will not take place, or the update will be very, very low updates over the number of iterations. Let us take the next one, that is rectified linear unit. Rectified linear unit function, it looks like this. Okay, so it takes values. If my z value, that is again for this also pre-activation will remain same, but after pre-activation function, if z value is positive value, then this ReLU activation function returns same Z value as whatever input was there, that will be the output. Fine. for positive value of z. For negative value of z or for zero value of z, what it will do, it suppresses to zero. From the figure only, you can see that for negative values, it or for zero also, it remains zero. Whereas for positive values, it takes, a will take same as z. Okay, this is the first case for this is the first case for positive value. This is the second case for zero or negative values. Okay, so it activates only for positive inputs. That means I may have computed z. Okay, that is pre-activation result may be negative, but based on this particular ReLU function, we know it only takes for negative function, that is whenever z is less than zero or zero, it suppresses the result to zero only. Okay, so and for positive value, it retain the same value. So it activates only positive inputs, thereby it is not activating the values for the negative input. Okay, so as it is activating only positive inputs, as a result the network becomes sparse and efficient. If the network is sparse, then I can say that this particular problem will be the problem of dense network computation of so many computations will not going to take place, correct? Because that is not activated, that particular neuron is not activated, so it will be sparse. The network is sparse, then I can say computationally it is very easy. Even with the help of equation, if I need to represent this particular function with the help of some equation, then I can write the output as A is equals to correct. So it takes for negative value, it results the maximum between 0 to z value. Okay, so it activates only the positive inputs as the network becomes the sparse and efficient. Also, one more advantage of using ReLU is, apart from this sparse, apart from creating the sparse network, it also gives the or overcomes the problem of vanishing gradient. The next function that is activation function is softmax function. The softmax function is computed based on this particular formula or equation, correct? So here A here is the again the output, fine. So it is computed upon based upon e to the power of zi divided by summation of all k, e to the power of zk. So this softmax function basically it is used at the output layer. Okay, why it is used at the output layer? Because this softmax function gives the probabilities, some probabilities to define each class for a particular type of input. Okay, and more importantly, I use softmax function in case of whenever I need to do multi-class classification. Okay, so for example, I do have some value, okay, some result at the output unit. Okay, so the output unit, it produced three different neuron values. Okay, this is y1 hat, this is y2 hat, and this is y3 hat. Fine. So what about what if I want to classify this is the result of we all know that from where I get the output unit values. Okay, from the previous hidden layer. Okay, whatever computation that previous hidden layer has done, so it simply passes to the next layer, that is output layer. And in the output layer, I have three different values in the given vector. The first vector is representing result of y1 hat. The second one is representing y2 hat and third one is representing y3 hat. It is very much clear to you that because there are only three neurons in the output layer, so what I wanted to do or what I want to do is I just want to represent the network output layer in three units. Okay, that means I want to classify the given problem in three different classes, y1 hat, y2 hat and y3 hat, and these are the three different values that we have got with respect to each of the output neurons of the output layer. So what we need to do is we need to apply this softmax function to get the probability for each of the given input, right? So what I will be doing is I will be computing exponential value for z of 0, that is whenever we do perform e to the power of z, so it comes out to be for minus 1 it comes out to be 0.3679. for next one, for the y1 y2 hat, it comes out to be 2.718. for y3 it comes out to be 148.4, right? So now what we need to do is, based on the equation, I need to compute the probability for the first class, probability for the second class, and what is the probability for the third class. And for that sake, what I need to do is I will take this value over summation of all three. Similarly, if I need to compute probability for this particular function, this particular neuron, then I will take this value over summation of these three. Similarly, probability of this value upon summation of all these three. Okay, so for that sake, for each computing probability for with respect to each neuron, I do require total probabilities. Okay, all these will be added, so it comes out to be, the summation comes out to be 151.4859 something, right? So let me compute for y1 hat, it comes out to be 0.002482428. For y2 hat, if you compute, it comes out to be 0.01794. Similarly, if I compute for y3 hat, if we compute, then it comes out something about around 0.9796. Okay. So like this, for the given problem, okay, if I want to do some multi-class classification, then what I can do is I can use, for multi-class classification or binary classification also you can use, that is not an issue, you can use this particular softmax function. Okay, why we use softmax function? Because it is giving us the probability. Okay, it gives the probability whether the input, whatever input that you have fed, okay, for testing purpose, whether it belongs to the first class, whether it belongs to the second class, or whether it belongs to the third class, okay, last class, right? So when I check the input, and when I compute the result, and the result itself suggests that the probability of getting this x, the input x, it belongs to the third class, as compared to as we are having less probability of getting that x as a second class or the first class. Fine, so given three classes, based on the probability values, based on the result, I can easily say that that particular class belongs to which of the, or that particular input belongs to which of the class. Here it belongs to this particular class, correct? And one more thing, let me make you clear. In this, what we have is, we do have taken k is equals to 1 to m. That means here it is indicating number of classes that we wish to get multi-class classification result. Correct? Okay, I have a very small exercise for you. Just try to compute the respective probability values with the help of softmax function. Here, as in the previous case, multi-class classification problem, we wanted to define the problem into three different classes. Whereas here we wanted to define the given problem into, I want to define into five different classes. And the output layer has these values. So what you do is you just try to get the softmax function of this output layer. Take some time. I may give you 5 minutes of time and try to compute the softmax function. Sakshi, I'm done with today's session. So now I can take the queries, if any.
Okay, ma'am. Anyone having any doubt in today's lecture or yesterday's lecture?
Ma'am, I have a query.
Yes, yes, you can ask.
In softmax function, why we always need 2 equals to 151, or what should number we take equal to?
Can you repeat, please? In softmax function.
In softmax function, what is the value that we need to take equals? Like you, like your previous example, you have taken 151 point something.
Let me share the screen with you again. I don't know what you are asking. Is my screen visible?
No, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. It's visible.
Okay. Okay. So, you have any query with respect to softmax function?
Yes. The example you took in which value is equal to 151.
Okay. This one? This one?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. What do you have the problem here?
Ma'am, what? Ma'am, ye jo final value aapki nikli hai 151.
Yeah.
Isko ye har bar 151 hi rahegi ya change, ye kaise change hogi?
It will remain 151 na, because you see this, I have taken this. It's up to you. I thought again and again I need to compute na the denominator value.
So okay, ma'am. Same for every
case. Yes. It will, because that is the summation value that we are considering, na? Exponential of z of 0, 1, and 2. So it comes out to be 151 only for this particular problem. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. And ma'am, the problem that you have given, how can we include the value on that one?
How to include?
To conclude the value, the latest.
Okay, you try to do, instead of three different values, I have given five different values. That means I want to classify the problem, any given problem, into five different classes. For that sake, it has generated some five values. Okay, so what I need to do is, again, you compute this exponential of z of 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, 0 to 4, you need to compute for five different cases. Okay. With the same example, you need to, with the same equation, you just put some values in the equation. Now, first I have computed this e to the power of z of I. That means e to the power of minus 1. So it comes out to be 0.3679. Similarly, now I will place that z value as 1, e to the power of z of 1, it comes out to be this. Actually, it remains same now, because this is the value of e. Similarly, e to the power of 5, it comes out to be 148.4. Now, okay, what you do is, you compute the total, that is summation of all exponential values. It comes out to be this. Once you get that, this divided by this, it takes gives the probability that problem belongs to this class is 0.0024. Second class, it comes out to be 0.01794. And third class, it comes out to be 0.9796. Okay. In okay, a similar way, compute e to the power of this 1.3, 5.1, e to the power of this, and so on. And later on, add all, and you will get some softmax function values, which are associated with each. That is probability it gives whether the problem belongs to this. What is the probability that the problem belongs to this class, this class, this class, and this class? And let me know what value you will get. Fine.
Okay, ma'am, got it now. It's clear.
Okay. Any other query?
There is a query in the chat window. What is the impact on output layer and hidden layer changes?
What is the
impact on output layer when hidden layer changes?
Output layer. Okay. In between, if you are adding any neuron, or in between, if you are changing any intermediate parameter values, then definitely that will be effect. That will have an effect on the output. Okay. You can see any of the activation pre-activation function and activation function. Any small change in one of the parameter value or any input unit, then definitely output will be changed. We will see by changing what value the output changes and why we should always try to update the values in each of the iteration. That might be clear by you, clear to you theoretically, but with the help of some examples and backpropagation algorithm, we will try to illustrate in subsequent classes how do we change, okay? How do we update the values so that my loss function will get reduced? Okay, that algorithm is very important. We will discuss that in detail.
Anyone having any other doubt? I don't think there are more doubts, ma'am. I think okay. We can end the session then.
Okay, Sakshi, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I have pasted the attendance link in the chat window for today. So everyone kindly fill that form on time. Otherwise, and after 1 hour, we won't accept any responses from your side for the attendance form. So thank you so much, everyone. Kindly fill that form on time.